is released against you, you got to stand up and declare with your mouth, it's my joy and I need it now. Glory to God. Hallelujah. The Bible declares the joy of the Lord is my strength. And this is not just a joy for the mere sake of material gain, fame for a name, or for someone just favoring you. But this is a joy that is unequivocally, meaning without a doubt, unstoppable against all odds. That means if anything, everything, if the devil throw everything at you, including the kitchen sink, if all your friends leave you, hallelujah, if your mother and father forsake you, you got to understand that the joy of the Lord, the precious commodity of spiritual things, far outweighs any inability in the things that we hold so dear and near to our hearts. And so this is the season to cut these things off. This is a season to cut everything off that is so easily beset you. The Bible says, run the race of God with patience, fear, and trembling. In other words, cut off, do away, do asunder with everything that so easily beset you. And this is a season where people are really fickle. And as times, the season and the faith of God, the trial and test of God intensify, we seem to get more and more fickle. Why? Because it is our environment that's sucking us in like a vacuum. And so we got to rise up to the occasion of the now. How many of those say it is the now faith? Amen. It is the faith that is working today. You know how I say yesterday was stale. You know why yesterday is stale? Because the yesterday's anointing, yesterday's faith did what it's supposed to do for that day. But I'm in the knowledge to know that the word of God say my mercies are made new every day. And so it behooves us to shake ourselves from everything from yesterday. I ain't gonna bring yesterday into my day. I'm not gonna bring 2013 into my 2014. The only thing I'm gonna bring in to my 2014 is my remembrance that I won, because I stood still and I saw the salvation of God in 2013. You need a testimony. You need a testimony. And your testimony is not for an occasion to say, well, Lord, look at God. But it's for you to remember, like David, I remember when. Remember David saying, I remember when the lion bear, you come after me, devil. I don't know you. David began to testify. So we're going to talk about today. We're going to get into the weapons of our warfare. You may be seated. And we're sorry to teach you a little bit on praise and worship. We got a time schedule to meet today. So we kind of like cut our services, our morning worship down. But we ain't going to cut this word none. We're going to get all of it. We're going to eat all of it for today. And then we're going to move forward in our planned day. And so this morning we are continuing in our teaching series, the very branding of this ministry, URAP teaching series, understanding, receiving, and activating the power of God. We have been in the book of Acts for a couple of years now, a little over 2 years, and we have been really supping up Acts the 13th chapter, the 26th verse, where Paul began to preach and began to herald out the word of God in the company of the saints. He began to encourage the people of God. And he began to call them out as to who they are. The Bible says, let the wheat and tare grow together, but in the day of harvest, he will do the separation. So it is our duty to herald out, to encourage, to spew out the word of the Lord amongst the, in the company of the saints. We have no idea who God is going to save, who he's not. So it's not our business to pick and choose who we gonna give this gospel to. And so he began to encourage the people of God, and he began to call them, you sons of Abraham. How many know that's a vast thing? Those three words. And so we've been teaching this thing, and it has become the branding of Wholeness Empowerment Ministry. URAP. Every individual have to URAP this word around his own soul. You say with me, I got to understand this word. I got to receive it, and I got to activate the power for myself. I refuse to be like the five foolish virgins. So wholeness is God's way. And we can't embark upon the wholeness of God until we are willing and enabled by his Spirit. The Bible talks about in the book of Matthew, when John the Baptist began to baptize Jesus, the heavens was open and the Spirit of God came down and rested upon the Savior. And then the Spirit of God began to speak over the head of the church. Wow. Hear God today. He said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And so the heaven were open from that day. Oh, Peter got it. Say with me, Peter got this. Remember when Peter, last week we talked about Peter. And Peter began to expose when Christ said, who do you say I am? Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then God told him, Peter, flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but it was my Father. I just want to reflect on last teaching. And he said, upon this very word, upon this very understanding of who I am, whatsoever you shall forbid on earth shall be forbidden in heaven. So Jesus began to give Peter the keys to the kingdom. Say with me, I got the keys to the kingdom. And so on last week, teacher, we understood in this teaching series of wrapping the word around us, our soul, that we might not sin against God. We are in the process of exercising our spiritual authority. We are in part 10 of God's weapons of mass destruction. And so he understood that the power that was invested in Christ, he had. Why? Because it was Christ that spoke over him. And so you have that same ability. So therefore, there's a transitioning that every child of God must be willing to rest upon, to visit. Say with me, I got to give up my inability for Christ's ability. The heavens are open for me, over me. And God honors my very words. This is the year of proclamation. It is a year of opening your mouth. As we dissect and we explicate those weapons and what they are and what they entail, you need to catch this. So Jesus told Peter, you have the keys to the kingdom. Whatever you open your mouth and you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Then he told him, whatever you open your mouth and you loose on earth, it shall be loosed in heaven. And so in a couple teachings ago, we understood what the word binding means. We just can't be saying the word, saying I bind you in the name of Jesus. I bind you this and I bind you that. And I understand that the very word is to be bound upon our heart. And so we explain what the word bind means. Three levels of the word binding. The first level we talked about is binding means to quadre. I believe it's Q-U-A-N-D-R-A-Y, which means to put that individual into a predicament, to put him in a tight spot, to basically box him in. And so when you bind the devil, you can say, I quadre you. Make it plain. I command you to go into a predicament. I cause all of your mechanism, your stratagems to be ostracized, to be basically obliterated against me. To go into utter dysfunction. I command everything you put your hands to be totally confused against my life, against my children, against my church, against the body of Christ, against the promises of God for my life. I quadre you. The Bible says the kingdom of heaven is something violent, and it is the violent. You can't play with it. I don't know how you do when you pray, but when you're dealing with the devil, you got to deal with him with an attitude. Say, I hate him. You got to be the one to tell him, hell no, I'm not dealing with you today. Why? Because hell is his domain. So another word for binding means to attach. We said attach means to bring it all together, to bind it together. Like this this edifice, this house over here that prophet made for the stable of Christ. He took wood and he bind it together. And then he brought forth a product. So that's what we want. We want the word to be attached to our heart. Then we want to uplead the word. We went over that word uplead, meaning that the word is now attached to my heart. Now I want to uplead it. I want the word to be forced and compelled into action. The Bible says, bind the word upon the tables of your heart. Write it upon the tables. Bind it upon your soul. Write it. Let it be written. And so you got to speak and proclaim. I call the word to be bind to me. The word of God, I call it to be oblique. I call it to be forced into action. I call the promises of God to be forced into action on my benefit. The Bible says, if you say unto this mountain, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me stick with my notes. And so we're still, let's go to Ephesians 6 right quick. I'm so excited about this word. I love this word, and it is this word that got me here today. I'm alive because of the word. I can live in Christ and know who I am and exercise my spiritual authority because of the word of God. You know why? Because it is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word. It is the Spirit of God. And I see it that way. And so we're going back to Ephesians 6. We already dealt with the 10th through the 12th verse. We already dealt with the fact that Mark, the 16th chapter, say with me, I ain't gonna let nobody intimidate me. I can exercise this word too. I can deal with a devil. I can walk in power. I can walk in the miraculous. I can tell the devil no. I can lay hands on the sick. I can speak to devils and they got to obey me. So we already established in Mark 16:16 that this word of God, this power is for the mere believer. This has nothing to do with those with a title. This is for that anyone who believes in Christ can walk in the miraculous power of God. This year, we're declaring this to be the year of the miraculous of God. So when you declare something like that, when you decree a thing, the Bible says you'll let it be established. Say with me, I got a decree and then I wait for it to be established. See, it is your word that calls the thing to be decreed, and your faith makes it established to the point where it's not, you don't see it yet, but faith will bring it into vision. We're going to talk a little about faith this morning. So this morning, we're getting into the 13th verse. Let's go down to Ephesians 6:13. And this mini-series. We had mini-subtitles. We're still armored. Say with me, I'm still armored and engaged in God. As a matter of fact, I'm armored and engaged in God. Indefinitely.
Lord of God.
That means there's no occasion for it. Well, I'm not armored today. Play with it if you want to. Many people are snared by the devil because of ignorance. Because of a slight occasion to just have a little folly. Say, we ain't got time for folly. I need my needs met. You know why? Those who do not walk in the wholeness of God will not survive this season. It is only the power of God that keeps us in the earth. There is no in between. The man is either in Christ or he is not. There is no middle ground. Say with me, there is no middle ground. I'm in Christ. That settles it. So we went over these different topics. We already learned how to battle God's way and win. We already learned what God's... Now we're learning what God's weaponries are. We're breaking them down. Learn how to put them on for keeps. We went over that. We're learning how to skill. We already learned how to skillfully use them. And we learned how to discern our opponent. We did that when we talked about the devil. Learn how to beat him at his strategy. Learn how to know when to fight. We haven't done that yet. But learn how to maintain status quo. So we're now in learning how to put them on for keeps. Ephesians 6:13. Notice here in the scripture where it says again, and it reminds us. I don't know about you, but when I read the word, when I study the word, I learn that the word is very repetitive. It will say it up here, and then it'll say it in the middle, and then it'll close it out and say the exact same thing. Say, well, I need to catch that. I need to catch this word and what it's saying to me. See, you haven't caught it until you... Absolutely. You got to do it. Here it goes again. Therefore, put on every piece of armor. Ain't that the same as the verse up top? Say, put on the full armor. It's the exact same thing. So you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Say with me, there's a time of evil. And the time of evil is now. Let me tell you something. You think evil sleeps? It don't. It works in the most strategic ways that you have no idea. That's why we have better wake up and discern everything. And discern it. If it breathes, say with me, if it breathes, I need to discern it. But everything you discern is not for you to tell everybody. I'm always gathering some things. Some things I don't even share with you guys. Some things is just for the prayer altar.
That's right.
It's just for intercession. When you want people to do that for you,
yeah.
That's the way it goes. So then, after the battle, you will be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes. Put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. 18 verse, pray in the Spirit at all times. Sometimes. Pray in the Spirit. All times. And on every occasion, stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And so we see here the instructions of God is to be sure that you have on every piece of God's full armor. Once you are born again, you are a child of God, you have on the armor. Time, move your seat, please, on this side of the room. Once you put on, you're saved and you know Christ, you have on God's armor. But you can have some things in your possession and not even realize that you have it. Say with me, I need to recognize. So I can come alive. And stop letting things just beat me down.
Stop that thing to beat me down.
So God's weapons of vast destruction is just for the mere living of the child of God's life. But if you don't recognize you got this, how can you do anything? How? And so this is his instruction. This is so that we can be covered in every battle. Whether it is the battle of truth against our soul, whether it's the battle of our faith, fear and anxiety is coming up against us, where it's the battle for the provision of God, for the promise of God, for us to be able to claim hope to what is rightfully ours, where it is, whether it is the battle where we're dealing with sickness in our body, I need to have on the whole armor.
Yes.
And I need to have it on God's way. We already dealt with that. I got to operate God's way. So learning how to do it God's way is going to require some tests. It's going to require some trials. Many of you don't even really believe that you're saved. And there are many that are really not saved, who think they are such a great oxymoron going on. The word will always tell you where you are. Say with me, the word will tell me where I am.
The word will tell me where I am.
This ain't about this vessel. This is about this word. The word will tell me the truth.
The Lord God.
And that's what it's going to do. It's going to tell me the truth. So whether it's against my provision, the fact that I'm saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, all these are going to come up against me. There will be a testing time. I got to get ready for this test. I got to be proven. Many of you need to get back into the book of James. Go to the book of James and stop letting the devil wear you down. I got to be tested. My faith got to be developed. And so I got to be ready at all times. This is paramount in winning. Should I be ready when I'm in the mall? You think the devil going to bother? The devil ain't going to bother me because I'm shopping. I'm having a good time. It's my birthday. I'm going off, you know what I mean? Will the devil bother me? Would the devil, do he take a break? The Bible say that you will be ready on all occasions. So your willingness to prepare ahead of time is predicated on your winning. I got to be ready. I got to know that my weaponry is, it works. God said, if you submit yourself therefore unto God, resist the devil and he'll flee. That protocol seems so simple. But if we could master that, submit ourselves therefore unto God, like the scripture say, resist the devil and he'll flee. So when I submit myself to God, I'm submitting to his what? Armor. I'm submitting to his weaponry. Everyone that names the name of Christ must submit to the weaponry of God. You're going to learn today, if they ain't submitted to the weaponry of God, they don't know him. They are not saved. People need to understand this. Wholeness is God's way. And God has not just thrown something out there for us to accomplish that. He has not gone ahead of us and made provision for our success. Glory to God. And so we're going to bring an explanation to all these weaponry and that you are enabled as a child of God to use them. Learning how to put them on for key is your willingness to understand, receive, and activate the power of God. This is how you put them on for key. Understand, receive, activate the power. When? Yesterday? When I activate the power, I said the sinner's prayer. I said, Lord, forgive me about 30 years ago. Now is the day I gotta wrap God around my soul. I gotta wrap this word around my soul. I gotta know that I have this for keeps. Say with me, I have it for keeps. That which a man understands, knows, and values is what he will do. I'm going to say that again. That which a man understands and knows is what he values. And it is what he will do. And so there is a branding of the soul. There is a branding of the heart. There is a great impression on the heart that is made upon you. People make, see, pedophiles make impressions upon people. And many times when people want to lure you into something, whether they want to befriend you in the neighborhood, be your friend, for whatever. Some people befriend people just to rob them, just to come in their home. People got all kind of reasons for influencing and infecting people. Their agenda. So if you don't allow the agenda of the world to impress you, to brand you, to value, to make your standard value in Christ, then you're open for anything. Your portals, your gates are open for branding on any side of the devil. See, there's only two brandings. You're either branded in Christ, where this thing is in your heart and you can't help it. James said, God said, and I believe it is in, it might be 1 John 3:9. Those that are born of God have the seed of God in them. And they cease from sin. They cannot sin, the Bible says, because the seed is born in them. Does that mean everything a child of God do is right and they always right? No. It means they're hidden. They've been branded. They've been stamped. They don't play with sin. Right. They don't say, well, grace don't cover me so I can do this right now. Proud people do that. He said he resists the proud, but his grace is to the one who humbles themselves. To the branding. You don't, you submit yourself every day. You know that. Why? Because there's a devil loose. And you know that self is still alive. Why? Because I die daily, as Paul said. I got to deal with me. So listen to this. Value brings impression to a man's heart. And impressions ignites passion, which ensues action without force. That's oblique. That's that compelling. That's that blend branding. I'm going to say that again. Value brings impression. You see a nice piece of jewelry? You see a nice piece of jewelry, something you like? Right. Wow, I like that. Right. I like that. You're impressed. And so you're not impressed just for the sake of being impressed. You're impressed because that's what value does. It stops you. It opens up your attention where you listen. You see folks that shut down on the way like, you make me sick. I don't want to hear that. No value. No branding. No impression. Say what we did on the self side. And self is loud and out loud. Living out loud. So it makes a great impression upon you, which ignites passion. And so this is what we have to be careful of. Where is our passion? Where is what's flaming us up? Is it the passion of lust flaming and burning in us? Or is it the flames of God? Say with me, I gotta watch that. This is what calls us to act. We're either gonna act at the word of God and the will of God, or we're gonna act at the word of self. The world and the devil. I don't care how saved you are. And I can say this again. Doesn't matter your title. Doesn't matter your gifts to prophesy. Doesn't matter. We are all subject to being our passion being turned. We ran well. The Bible said, well, what hindered you that you didn't begin, that you didn't keep it? Why? Because God started blessing and things started looking good. And now you say, oh, look at God blessing. So now I can lay back at ease in Zion. This is what many of us leaders do. The money start turning, the people start coming, the things start looking good. And we start being watered down in the things of God. This is why prayer must go ahead of us. Intercession is vital for all people, and especially the fivefold. Please keep the people of God in prayer, and thank God we are doing that. So our passions must be in God, just as a passion, just like a child is to his mother. The passion of God is inborn. It is an inherent ability. Once you are on fire for God, there's no putting it out. It's that inherent ability that you have. Nothing can fan the flames of God's fire and call it to dwindle out. Let that settle in you. I believe that. Let's learn what God's weaponry is in the explanation. First weapon is the belt of truth. Say with me, truth is a weapon. It's a weapon against every lie. Truth is one of your greatest assets. As a son of God, I want to make sure I get all this out. I might not finish this teaching. But what God has spoken in my heart, I want to make sure you get this. Truth is the light that causes a lie that comes from darkness to be ineffective, holding no reservation against God in your soul. This is the power of truth. If you can just get this word in your heart, the word of truth, no matter what God says, I want it. It will cause every reservation, every plan of the assassin to be null and void against you. It will form for a purpose of God, but it will not prosper because of the promise of God. You just need to believe that. It will form because of the plan and purpose of God, but it will not prosper because of God's promises. I love that. So it is God's opinion, truth is. We can understand why the Bible says, put truth around your waist like a belt. A belt is used in the midsection of a man's body. A belt is what we use to gird up the loins. The loins is right below the waist. A man put a belt around his waist, kind of look cuckoo. He do, he look like Urkel. Urkel is basically, he put the belt up high. That ain't the right place for a belt. A belt's supposed to be lower around the loins is lower than the waist. I mean, some people's body is built different. But your waist is higher than your loins. So the loins are the place where the strength of a man's body lies. If something is coming after you, you gird yourself. You guard yourself. You stabilize yourself. It is the midsection of a man's body where the power resides. That's why when you've had a problem with your spine and you've been one of your discs been injured, you go through such thing as sciatical nerve damage. It really weakens the entire body and causes the man, basically, it just shuts the body down, basically. But you can pray that devil off of you. So the truth must be tight around the man's standard of living, not giving any room for the occasion of self, sin, the world of devil. You got to tell these things, I can't work with that. David didn't want his leader's armor because he already had what he needed. Say with me, I need truth tight. Truth need to be tight. Truth need to be so up on me to stare me in the face. When I get up in the morning, I need to have truth right there with me. This is the power to stand against all adversaries. all diabolical wicked influence against you. Truth is your power. It is your reward. It is your declaration. It is your proclamation. It is your information. When you know where the devil goes, you can kind of tongue him and play with him. Like Ishmael did Isaac. You come on, devil. I understand that I have the power to deal with you. And I know that your time is not yet, but you ain't getting nothing done up in here. Why? Because I see you. He hates that. So everything, truth is God's opinion. Everything God says is right. I don't care whether he is reprimanding his children, whether he's blessing us, whether he's his righteous indignation is being released, whether you're reading the promises of God or the judgment of God. It is all right and it is good. Say with me, I got no complaints against God. Oh, for real? Well, why you act like that? I'm just joking, y'all. Y'all know, I had to throw y'all. No, even I did. I got to catch you. Why? So it is his kindness. Truth is, everything he does is his approval, and you can allow your thinking to go contrary to what truth says. It's like you putting water in your gas tank. Tell me I'm finna drive. I ain't gotta go to BP no more. I can just put water in them. It's not gonna work. You have got to have truth in order for the word of God to work for you. It's not gonna work. Your car not gonna work a water in it. It is only when the man is ready to believe and receive this belt of truth and tighten it up like never before that he isn't able to be considered. Listen to this, even for salvation. Don't like truth? Don't like salvation. Don't like salvation? Don't like heaven. Don't like heaven? You like hell. By default. So it's time for the man, it's time for the child of God to get over what we don't like. Especially when it's God. So salvation, glory to God, does not come before the man's willingness to believe and receive the truth. What God had me to do is when I set up the explanation of the armor, I set them up accordingly. Truth comes first. The mere profession of salvation is the surface of what a man seemed to be. You can say you saved all you want them. But it is the fruit of the man's lifestyle. The Bible says, you shall know them by their fruit. A good tree brings forth good fruit, while a bad fruit tree brings forth bad fruit. You will know them by their fruit. It's not a drama deep enough to fool God himself. Go with me, James 8:31. And so salvation is the speech of one's life through the explanation, an expression of liberated living. Salvation is the speech, the talk of your lifestyle. Meaning you're living every day and you're talking, you're speaking. You're declaring who you are in the marketplace, on your job, when people look at you. They see the glow, they see the glory. Demons will snarl at you. Why? Because they see the glory. They see the oil on you.
Yes, Lord.
You're talking to them. It is the expression of your liberated living. And don't think that because he see you that he won't try you. Don't let pride lie to you. Talking about the devil won't try me. Yes, he will. If God allow him to try Jesus, he'll try you. John 8:31. One of our focus scriptures for this ministry. Jesus said to the people who believed in him, hear every word that the Lord is saying. You are truly my disciples if you what? Remain faithful to my teachings. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The 33rd verse. Sound like some people who live in the church today. But we are descendants of Abraham, they say. We have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean you will be set free? Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave of sin. A slave is not a permanent member of the family, but a son is a part of the family forever. So if the son sets you free, you are truly free. And so salvation is not determined by men's understanding. This is the truth. Within the soul of man, there is always room for excuse as why I do what I do. You know, if that Adam and Eve said, well, the serpent did it, and Eve did it. Well, it was the man of the man. If you didn't give me the man, then I would have did it. Oh, really? This is the byproduct of misunderstanding. Man always got an excuse. And not even having an inkling or a thought of that he is bound. This is the byproduct of misunderstanding. You don't even recognize that you are bound. Why? Because error, lies, false doctrine, deception has been basically an enemy of the truth, that the gospel that has been preached basically since Abraham time. And the prophet spoke it. Isaiah spoke it. Isaiah was so well in explaining who the Messiah was and that he was coming. But yet when he came, they were so in tune. They were so religious and caught up into their everyday planning and maintaining of the way they did things. The truth itself was right before them, and they didn't understand. They went all the way back. Well, I remember when with my auntie, we all used to, you know. Well, I'm saying because my uncle was a bishop. Yeah. My mama was a pastor. Yeah, my auntie, my friend. Yeah, I remember my great aunt. They was all saved. So they had no idea what Jesus was talking about. Many of you don't have any idea that you're loved. That them soul ties that's dragging you into sin over and over again is spiritually killing you. And whatever God got to do to box you in, he gonna do it. So, this is what hinders a man from truly embracing salvation. Lies and error and deception. The way Jesus described it. He said, if you really are my disciples, he gave them an ultimatum. If you really my disciple, you'll walk upon its truth and you'll do it. That's if you really belong to me. He said, if you follow what I tell you, then you will know the truth. Then I will open up your understanding. See, many men try to be wiser than God. I'm going to try to fool God and walk in religious like the Pharisees did, like these disciples did, that were in so much error that they did not understand what Jesus was saying to them. If a man does not belong to Christ, he does not belong to God on the good side. Doesn't matter, as I said, how much a man proclaims he knows Christ. Say with me, I can never remain in sin. I can never remain bound to a sinful lifestyle. The Greek term for truth is yada. YADA apostrophe, meaning to come to know by learning. So this weapon, this belt of truth, I gotta come to know by experience. He said, if you are my disciples indeed, are truly my disciples if you what, remain faithful. So I got to see, we are capable of being faithful to a lot of things. You're faithful to believe that you're going to hold your age. So you can be faithful to God, to know that He's real. He said, then you will know. You will know the truth. Why? Because you, not the five wise, but you're going to walk this out. Say with me, I'm going to walk this out. I got to walk this truth out for myself. The power of the cross has enabled me. Remember, I connect vertically. And then I'm going to be a wise version. I'm going to extend my hands out to those. Why? Because I am a minister of the gospel. I am an ambassador. And I have this weapon of truth. I have this call, this mandate to call men back to God.
Glory to God.
How could a man be in a burning building and he's burning? How could a child be starving? How could anyone need water and you got it and you won't give it to them? Evangelism must come alive in the church today. So the man remains bound and a slave to sin, does not know God through experience. Truth. If he did, he will be free. That's what Jesus said. If you know me, therefore he does not belong to the family of God. Why? God only fathers children that he has brought great provision to. He said, I have called them and I've chosen them and they are what? Faithful. Then he said, my children, my sheep, what? Hear my voice and they do what? Obey. Such a tight pledge. That pastor can't get in there. He can fake all he wants, but he can't get through this word. He must walk it out. Our walk is free, meaning our talk is free. The love that we have in us is given freely. Why? Because I receive the love of God freely. I give it freely. My invitation to Christ, to the people, to give them Christ is unstoppable. I give it freely. Yeah. I receive the invitation to own up to truth. By having the standard of God. He said, you are truly belong to me if you remain faithful to my teaching. He made this statement not trying to snare them. People think you'd be trying to trick them up. You trying to control me. I've heard that word so much. I mean, grown people, minister, and you just trying to control me. I'm like, oh, what? He knew he already empowered the body of Christ, the church, to do this. So the word, he didn't tell them, he didn't throw this challenge at him, if you were truly to just snap him up.
Right.
Some people too smart. He just trying to, that's a trick question. If you were raised, what if we know? What about grace? Uh-uh. Go to the book. So he knew that the power, which is the word of God, the word of truth, is the Holy Spirit, which is the enabler upon the man, if the man will do well and receive him. Not the man being of his own willful power, but what? Of God's power. He said, not by your might, not by your power, but by what? My spirit. Many people in the body of Christ are trying to walk by their own power, their own intuition, their own gifts and ability, which are given without repentance. You can preach the gospel and sound so good and still live a wicked lifestyle.
Lord Jesus.
This is why he said, know those that labor among you. You don't know the man till you see his lifestyle. You don't know him because he preached the word of truth. You know him because he feels the word of truth. The gifts and call of God are without repentance. This is the power of God. This is the only way we can refrain from that which is sin and not true. It's to remain in Christ. Say with me, I got to remain in Christ. So they tried to throw a little fleece out there on Jesus, and they tried to use a little self-reasoning. We Abraham, see, didn't you know that? What you coming from? We know who he is. No, you don't. They tried that, which is always wrong. Our understanding in self is always wrong, and it's determined to go against our liberty. They ignorantly stood right before the truth and went all the way back, like I said earlier, back to Abraham. Could you imagine? You dealing with somebody about salvation, and they tell you about their dad died 50 years ago. You trying to win them to Jesus. Man, I can see myself just standing there and say, Lord, are you going to deliver me? Are you going to help me out? Because I'm shut down, Jesus. I just asked this man if he want to live today, and he told me about his dad 50 years ago that he used to preach. But this is, you know what? It's a strategy against the devil. You know what it do many times? Waste time. Yeah. You got to rebuke that. Yes, say with me, the truth of God's word make me free. I want to be free. Therefore, I want the word. I need the word to cut me so I can be free. Even though we weren't talking about the sword of the spirit, we was talking about truth. But we know truth is a word. Then there is the salvation as your helmet. I'm gonna try to finish salvation, and I'm gonna stop right now. Salvation in its Greek term means soteria, S-O-T-E-R-I-A. In its Greek term, means deliverance, preservation, safety from the enemy of the man's soul. Meaning I'm preserved, I'm saved, I'm brought into God's domain, his secret place. You know what Psalms 91 say? You need to love that scripture. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide. Let me tell you. The man thinks that he has right to go up under God's secret place and then go back and forth. Oh, today I'm under his secret place, but tomorrow I'm going to do my thing. You can't do it. You're either dwelling, you're either saved, you're either protected, you're either under his delivering hand, you're either under his provision of shepherding where you don't want anything else but him, or you're not.
That's the truth of it.
This is the highest call of man. It's the salvation, which is the call to eternal bliss. See, people don't even understand what salvation is. They think it's just a moment to go to heaven. No, it's like salvation right here. It begins in the earth. You are saved from any snare of the fowler, any assassin agenda. So it's the highest call. Then listen to this. It is symbolic to a helmet, which is in his Greek term, meaning perkephala. P-E-R-I-K-E-P-H-A-L-A-I-A. Perkephala. That's what helmet means. The Bible styles your salvation as perkephala, a helmet, which is the protection of the soul. The helmet goes what? On the head. That's where your soul is. In your head, your thinking, your natural soul. Your mind, your will, and your emotions. It's in your soul. It consists of the what? The hope of salvation. Listen to this. Jesus is the hope of every man's salvation. He's the one that keeps us. He's the one that shepherds us from what the wolf that would possibly. Remember David taking care of his father's sheep? There was a shepherd over the sheep. Jesus is the chief shepherd over his sheep. And so when his salvation is intact, he says, don't let the Father give me. You can't touch them devils. Why? Because they are under my perkephala. They're under my protection, which is my hope of salvation. And they know it. How could a man be saved and don't know he's saved? Let me tell you something. It ain't nobody till they told it. Just, oh, I'm in heaven. But the little children. This is an act of a man's will. The Bible explicitly say that. Say with me, my salvation is a weapon. So he is the weaponry of God, our salvation. It is the man's seal of eternal bliss with God. It comes as a result, as a byproduct of the first weaponry, which is truth.
That's right.
If you don't believe truth, if you don't receive truth, you can't get salvation. Receiving truth makes you, enables you to live a what? A saved lifestyle that leads to what? Life. But a sinful lifestyle, you give that up because of what you're saying now. That leads to what? Death. Salvation is not dependent upon a man's one-time confession. The Bible said, to as many as received him, gave him power to become. A man can say the sinner's prayer 10 years ago and go to hell today. To as many received him. To him gave them the power. If you're becoming something, what you do, you want working on it. And you're working on it your way, that sneaky devil way. Oh Lord, just give me a minute. I'm good, man. I just got to smoke this joint one more time. And God done told you 25,000 times to stop it. I just got to have sex one more time. I just got to let it feel me one more time. And that last time was you were done. He said, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Play with your friends, play with your baby doll, play with your little toy, remote control truck. But you don't play with God. And your salvation, say with me, I only got one life to live.
I only got one life to live.
So salvation is determined by a man's lifestyle, his will to possess what he himself says he wants. Are you nothing? Do you want it? The Bible says that the race is not given to the swift nor the strongest. To him who what? Hold now and endure to the end, the same shall what? Be saved. Though, this is the process of what grace brings. This is the process of the mercy of God. Being able to humble yourself to God and resist the devil, he'll flee. The Bible says he resists the proud, who can't submit to nobody or nothing but themselves. He resists the proud, but what he gives is grace to those who humble him, themselves. Those who possess this passion of wanting total bliss with God, what by faith. Let's go to the scripture. 2 Timothy 1:9. This is salvation. You got to take what's yours by force. If God tells you to take it by force, that means there's going to be some pressure against you walking in your weaponry, God's weaponry of vast destruction. 2 Timothy 1:9. For God saved us and called us to live what? A holy life. He did this not because we deserved it, but because that was his plan from the beginning of time, to show us his grace through Christ. And now he has made all of this plain to us by accepting, by the appearing of Christ Jesus, our Savior. We know he came right here to the earth. He broke the power of death and illuminated the way of life and immorality through the good news. So it is the good news of the gospel that is preached and received what consummate your weapon of salvation. The Father has already done his part for you to accomplish this. He's already given you his best. He's given you his Son, glory to God. He's already enabled us to accomplish this mission that has been completed in the earth. What Jesus said, it was finished. And so we must understand this, that this has nothing to do with how cute we are, or how smart we are, how many preachers in our family. We don't deserve salvation. This is not the reason he did it. Or we feel, well, I just feel, you know how some people are so opinionated? When they on the job and the man telling them doing one thing and they try to tell them off. But I just feel you just should give me another chance. I feel you just should let me. I feel that they just run their mouth so much. You talk yourself right out of what God will have you to have. It is the plan of God for us to seek. For him to seek. For Christ to seek and save what? Those who are lost. He does not wish, the Bible say, none shall perish, that all will come to an agreement. All will come into a covenant with salvation, with this weapon. I'm giving you an invitation. Well, everyone that hunger and thirst, come to me. I will give you rest. Everyone that's willing to make the transition, that 360 degrees turning around, coming off of self all the way around and facing the very thing that's going to make you please God. Meaning, I had a change of heart. I have been able to receive the full grace of God and the truth. Why? Because I've seen Christ. I've heard his message. I know, I understand what he's done for me. Now I embrace it with joy. I embrace it with passion. I embrace it with love. I embrace it with gratitude. You know, most people handle the virgin birth lightly. It don't mean nothing to them. The book of Matthew, how Jesus come, don't mean nothing. They don't know the story. Many of them say, that ain't really true, that Mary. Ain't nobody can be born and don't have no baby. You know people that say that Christian believe that? Oh, shit, it wasn't no virgin birth. I believe this part, but I ain't gonna believe that. Okay. So it is the power of God that gives the saving grace of God that enables us to move from being a sinner to a saint. This is the power that saves a man's soul. As the scriptures say, it is by grace that we are saved and not of ourselves. It is a gift. We cannot brag. We can't boast. Well, God just did it for me because I'm like that with God. No, you ain't. He don't know you. He don't know anything when it comes down to the boasting of a man's heart. When it comes down to a pride, he only knows the humble. We never can boast about such great things as salvation. We never can boast about the miracles of God coming on in the scene and the glory of God resting upon our very presence. We should just be at awe and humble. God, I'm just so thankful that you just thought about visiting me, Lord. You ever give somebody a gift and they basically throw it back at you? They take the value of your hard-earned money and basically tell you, you know what, really, I ain't want that. If I see it, I want my stuff back. I'm going to be real with you. Because my father think the same way. He's a wise investor. He said, if you go to a man and they don't receive you, do what? Knock the dust off your feet. And then you know what he said? Let your very peace return. Let me take it back. Get that from my daddy. Glory to God, let me finish up this. So we should, the glory of God, having all things available to us spiritually, that we shouldn't have wanted for anything. The Lord is my shepherd. You don't like the 23rd Psalms? I shall not want. You don't pray that? Because if you don't make him your shepherd and you don't use your weapon of salvation, that's why you're full of lust. That's why, that's what makes your heart broken. That's why you always want. I ain't happy today because I didn't get what I want. Huh? When the very 23rd Psalm says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want for anything. The Bible said, whatever state you find yourself in, be there with content. Say with me, tight, but it's right. So how can a man have such a position in the glory of God? Into that which is spiritual from his very beginning he was, and miss it. I was waiting for the young man to say the other night, you are a spirit. You don't have a spirit. You are a spirit. Say with me, I am a spirit. I have a soul. And I live in this body. The real you is spirit. Glory to God. How could you miss it? The way, when a man missed the salvation of God, that means he's dead spiritually. And there has not been any saturation. There has not been any penetrating of the Spirit. When the Spirit hasn't penetrated the man's soul, nothing. There's no conception. You ain't pregnant. People be talking, I'm pregnant. I'm having this baby. Stop lying, you ain't pregnant. Seriously, though, there are women looking right now today lying, told me they're pregnant from bad men and all kinds of stuff. Tell the man they're pregnant, they ain't even pregnant. Just lie. Like you can tell the devil, you ain't no God. You're a man. He ain't that. So how could he miss it? He missed it because he's the same seed. We can no longer allow ourselves to be deceived and walk in any way contrary to what this word say. This word got to mirror our souls. Christ's grace was available from the beginning because our God is what? Omniscient in all his ways, meaning he is Jehovah El Roi. He see everything. Not only do he see everything, but he is omniscient, meaning he knows everything. He knew from the beginning that the man was going to fall from the glory. This is why we all should be crying out, God, usher me into your glory. Because the glory, Ichabod, is really on the church. It really is. I sat and listened to the young man, I'm like, did he go on our website? Did he listen to our videos? He basically ditto the mantle of holiness in our religion. You know why the glory? Basically, God rests in such a, he does rest upon us because the glory allows us to still see and it illuminates truth. But there's a manifestation of glory where you can literally see it like they saw it. I mean miracle signs and wonder according to God's way. Where when the glory falls, you can't even stand because it's so heavy. Deception is the enemy against the church. Truth is going to usher the glory back into the church in an unusual way. And I believe this is the season that the fire of God will rain upon everyone that is beckoning him. Because he said, you don't got it because you don't ask. And then he said, some of you ask and your heart ain't right. So we can do this. We can meet the requirement of God. And it's not just for wholeness, but it's the body of Christ corporately. Every joint supplies. As leaders, we got to stop this. Oh, this word is just for my people. When we started wholeness almost 5 years ago, The Lord said, every word come out of this house. And I didn't know where he was going to take us with such a powerful teaching, branding. He said, every word come out of this house needs to be recorded. It has been all this time. And we have shared it globally. I got another invitation the same day the young man told me. And not only that, you're going to be invited to Africa. I got an invitation that same day he told me that. I went back to my email and this pastor from Africa. But I had gotten invited about a year or so ago. One of my friends on Facebook, we've been talking back and forth for maybe about a year and a half. But this was somebody totally different from Africa that invited me that very same night that he told me that. Because wholeness. You say, I've been listening to your website, I go on your website and I listen. Wholeness is what the church must preach. We must bring people into the right alignment of this word. That we can no longer allow the excuses, stand with me, of flesh. The excuses of self-reasoning and all these enemies. And I'm going to preach that one day in regards to goodbye. Why the Spirit of the Lord had departed from the people of God. Even the Ark of the Covenant that caused it to be taken was many times it's because of our own deceptions, because of our own issues. The Word of God, the Church of the Living God, is a place to come. And fellowship is a place where we come and we hear what God has to say. It's not a place where we come to run around and jump and shout out the chandeliers and didn't we have a good time. It is a time to come to get filled with the Word of God. That when I go back out the four walls, I'm so full that I can't help but walk in the whole armor of God. You got to say with me, I got to see myself up and down. And that's what I have for me. I see myself. Just like the eyes of the Lord, the Bible talks about search to and fro in the earth, looking, show himself. Where can I pull myself out? Who got this? Whose ears are open to understand? Whose ears are open to receive this and walk in it? The church. Just like John wondered, this great scroll in your hand, oh sovereign great God, with these seven seals on it, you know what I'm saying? Without God, who is going to open and reveal what's in these scrolls? Then one of the elders began to say to Christ, the Son of the Living God, the Savior, only he is worthy. And so that is the church. If God said he's going to have a church without spot or wrinkle, that is the way it will be. And so we're not even turned on by what we see horizontally, but we're turned on by what God said. This is what faith will cause us to do. Say with me, faith will cause me to connect with what God
said
and not what I see.
So
therefore I am a candidate of the miraculous power of God
right here in the earth.
Father, we just thank you for your word. Come on and give it praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. God, your word empowers us today. Your word enables us. Your instructions, your dunamis, oh God. Your inherent power, oh God. We open ourselves and we receive it today. Oh God, we receive your word just as it is. And we receive was open to hear what the Spirit has to say. We rebuke every enemy, every snare, every assassin that comes to steal the word. Whether it be by memory, whether it be by the cares of this life, whether it be by going through, we rebuke it. We quadrate it right now. In the mighty name of Jesus, we bind every enemy that will come and try to snatch the seed of the word. Hallelujah. We call you this.
you shall be all that God has called you to be. And if as you say, I shall be all that God has called me to be. I shall do all that God has called me to do. I shall have all that God says I can have. And this is to his glory and honor alone. Like never before. It's time for the word of the Lord to spring forth out of your belly. It's time for the fruit of God's Spirit to spring forth up out of your belly. It's like you can't even hold it. I mean, it's just festering up till you just gotta get out. And it's gonna happen outside the four walls, the word of the Lord. It's gonna come for a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. And it's going to be a word that the people know it had to come from God. Because they don't even know you. They've never seen you before. But the gifts of God will intensify in this house, in the body of Christ, in the universe at large. It's going to be newsworthy. This is the year that no longer the enemy will be a reproach to the things of God. Neither will he use people to be a blame against the holiness of God. Say with me, devil, it won't work. God say it won't work. I hear God say he's going to rise up with the healing of God upon his wings. The healing all upon his wings. And the church is going to rest in healing. Healing. This is a season of healing. He said, my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. This is the season of healing. So anytime when we're interceding and when we're praying, we're calling for healing. Healing. God, we thank you. Let's praise him for his healing. We thank you for your healing. And for the souls of your servants.
Stir. Yeah. prophesy. It calls those hard things to become made available. Where you can look at them and say, my God, I know this ain't nobody but Jesus. You watch what God does in you. Hallelujah. The gift of God is going to be so stirred in your feelings and your dreams are going to change. You're going to understand some of the dreams that you did not understand that brought confusion. But God said you are in a safe place. You are in a place where you'll be elevated. Glory be to God, because there's much work. You've been in leadership in the government, but God said, I'm going to call you to be in leadership in my kingdom, where it's a spiritual mantle that is resting upon you. It's a spiritual mantle. This is nothing tangible or natural. It's a mantle that gives you eyes to see. Your insight, your spiritual insight, it's going to be, that's why some things bother you. When God get ready to elevate you spiritually in your eyesight and your understanding and discernment, you get frustrated. Because you get frustrated, you feel out of place. And you feel like, I just feel like I'm shut in. I feel like I'm shut down. I feel like I'm boxed in. Because there's so much more. It's like stopping. Cut that off for me, please. It's like a well that's been stopped up. It's been shut down, but yet the dam has been broken and the water wants to spring out. But yet because there's a stoppage here, there's a block. That block is called frustration. But now the Lord says you're going to spring forth and worship and praise. Understand it. So praise it to you, Lord. I just feel this thing. I feel this thing like never before. And then you're going to walk it out. He never tells us everything at the beginning. He never does. We basically walk it out. And then he speaks to us and we say, for real, God, you want me to do that? And we just do it. Like we're crazy. You know, I'm going to do it. You know? And he said, do it, I'm going to do it.
Right. Amen. Hallelujah.
That's the requirement of faith. It's weird. It's not like the kind of faith that we have worldly. Right. I know this chair ain't gonna move.
Right.
No, I ain't need faith to sit down. But yet it was trust that caused me to sit down.
Right.
I was confident in that chair. Oh, come on now.
Yeah.
But this faith is unfamiliar. You can't see it. I studied that thing yesterday. We got to it in our teaching today. But it's just weird. Totally off the record scale. Yes. And like I was telling you the other day, I feel like somebody just carrying me. It's weird. Don't you feel that way? Like God is just carrying you. And you just walking in the right place. And I know you feel like that. God say, I needed to show you that. I need to show you all that, even the thumping of the toe, is a part of your learning. You needed to do that. So next time, I love it though. Because the grace give me room, said it would be grace give me room to even grow without missing.
Such a truth.
If we didn't have that, all of us would be done.
Yes.
I know I would. All of us would done.
Cause us to break forth. And it's going to cause such an explosion in the spirit. I just feel there's an explosion.
Amen.
In the spirit. And my God, I know when the apostles get here on Thursday night, I know there's going to be a release, an endowment that she's going to leave in this place, glory to God. But there's an explosion in this worldwide. It's corporately. And it's only some that is feeling it. But God is giving it enough to some that it's enough to cover those. And then those that didn't get it, they'll be okay. They'll find themselves under that covering where their eyes will be open. You think God will allow the devil to win out on him? It is not. I'm glad to have both of my sons in the house this morning. And we just wanted to stay in the house of the Lord. And one of my nephews.
to hear God. We have literally seen the effects of our prayers and our intercession.